share this too. Right. Thank you. Thank you for receiving me and giving me the opportunity to address such distinguished attendees. Actually, we are here in a visit to sign mainly the agreement, framework agreement with the Mercosur on free trade between Lebanon and the Mercosur. This is the main purpose of the visit, but nonetheless, it is a tour that we are making in Latin American countries in order to strengthen the relations between Lebanon and this very important part of the world, where we believe that because of two main reasons, we need to really have a much better relationship between Lebanon and that part of the world which is the Middle East, and Argentina and that part of the world which is the south of America. The first reason is that we have a big Lebanese diaspora, a big Lebanese community in all of Latin American countries, which is amounting to 3 times more those residing in Lebanon. This is an area where really we can benefit in all means, whether economical, political, cultural. And if we look at something that is measurable related to the economy, we see that it's not up to the level that we should be expecting. The second reason is that we are living in a unilateral driven mode in foreign policy. And a country like Lebanon that was created based on equilibrium cannot find its own equilibrium if does not live in a world that is ruled by equilibrium of powers and equilibrium in economy and politics. And a small country like Lebanon with other small countries in the world and even mid-sized countries like Argentina are almost marginalized on the international scene by the superpowers. When we had the Cold War, it was mainly bipolarized. When we had the unilateral period, it was monopolized. And in both cases, small countries and medium-sized countries, and I can even say, aside of the 5 permanent members of the international, of the Security Council, no one country can be considered as a giant country, even if it has the 5th of the population or the 6th of the economy. That doesn't matter, since the world is governed by one force, whether good or bad, whether it's bringing justice or not to the world, it is still one decision, it is still one guidance that may suit one country on one period and will not in another period. So only equilibrium for small countries like us can really establish the tranquility that we can, that we need. And this is the reason where we have the good experience of the non-aligned countries, the 77 plus 1 countries. All this and the international forums created some sort of existence. I cannot say balance, but they did figure in the balance, and that they had some weight. Now this was shown in the climate change debate, and this was somehow this created some weight in taking a decision in a certain direction or not taking a decision, and it proved its efficiency. But this was not reflected in matters that are related to the international peace, to the international stability, which are mainly decided in the Security Council. And this raises a big question about the kind of reforms that we have to have in the Security Council. Anyhow, I think that Latin America and Africa are two main continents where a number of the states and in the political weight and the economic weight are very important to try to create this equilibrium. And they are not yet playing the role that is required, because definitely we are having two big continents with no major role for one country in them. We saw the formation of the BRICS with Brazil from Latin America and South Africa and Africa. And in continuation with Russia, China, and India. But obviously, this did not give the role to Brazil to lead Latin America, nor to South Africa to lead Africa. And I'm not saying it's good or bad. All I'm saying is that there is no one driven force in Latin America or in South Africa, despite a general tendency, but no driven force to have one decision coming out of this continent. This is how we see many formations, political or economic, in Africa and in Latin America. And this is giving a big margin for the superpower, you know, to have its political maneuvers, where even with the BRICS or even with the great powers like Russia and China, equilibrium is not restored on the international arena. And this is where we believe that trying to have the kind of consultations politically and the kind of cooperation economically would give a bigger margin for countries like us to exist. This visit for us is, of course, trying to take advantage of the existence of the Lebanese diaspora, but at the same time trying to take advantage of the feeling of injustice that is prevailing in this part of the world, in Africa and in Latin America. And I will give you a small example. We had, in the last 44 months ago, the deportation or the kind of forced movement of 200,000 Yazidis and 200,000 Christians in Mosul in Iraq. And Lebanon had to contact the International Criminal Court to take action against the perpetrators, who were obviously well known. Well known because they were shown on TVs, they are known in addresses, and they are attacked by the international community. But we saw that this kind of pursuit will, along with the UN resolutions 2170 and 2178, will give us a chance to launch a judicial international mechanism in order to leave such criminals with crimes against humanity and war crimes, well described in the international law, to leave them without impunity. And now it's been 4 months that we did not find, on one hand, the launching of this process from the international court, nor the launching of a political process from any interested country, where we have 170 countries that are particularly to the international criminal court. No, none of these countries took action because maybe they did not find an interest. Whereas we see all the international justice is being applied only on Africa in so many cases, and tried here in Latin America, or at least used for threat. This explains how we are living under double standards, how the international mechanisms that we have are used only based on interests, not on principles. And the balance of interests, small countries and medium-sized countries will not show. They will never be well placed in this balance. So I think a gathering of these countries on the principles and on forcing the respect of international law and the respect of human rights and the respect of the human values is something that can give us the protection that we need. Here in Argentina, you face the occupation of the Malvina Islands. We faced it in Lebanon with the occupation of our lands from Israel, and in previous times from other countries like Syria, like Turkey, and the whole history, and the kind of political mandate from superpowers. We faced it, and even after we took our independence, we were still occupied later on by foreign countries, and we were not protected by the international law until the time where we were able to do it on our own, out of our legitimate right to free our country. We used what we had in hand as means to liberate our country, but we did not have the application of an international resolution, which was the resolution 435, which stipulated at that time the liberation of Lebanon. But no one country wanted to deploy any kind of effort or any cost on its economy, you know, to liberate a country like Lebanon, which was later on, for a country like Kuwait, for example, 2 years after, it was liberated. We are for the liberation, definitely, of any occupied country. But this is how you see where the interests can bring a superpower or a group of powers or a group of countries for their own interests, you know, to take any action. So this lack of the same standard in the international scene is not giving protection to countries like us. And this is where I believe that this gathering on these principles can give us what we deserve as countries who are only seeking peace and prosperity to our people, where through our small constituency, we can provide the diversity that the world needs. A country like Lebanon, even with 4 million people, but formed of 18 religions, being able to live together, to coexist, and to share together resources in a good way in some periods of time, and in a bad way in other periods of time. In good governance sometimes, and in corruption in other times. But they were able to commonly share this distribution of resources in a mutual understanding. This proves that humanity can live in peace and prosperity in difficult periods and in difficult places, like in the Middle East, where you have all kinds of conflicts and this small part of the world, but it's always on the headlines. Why? Because we have all kinds of tensions between religions, Christians and Muslims, inside the same religion, between Shia and Sunnis, between nations, Israel and the Arab countries, Iran and the Arab countries, Turkey and the Arab countries, and between races like the Persians and the Ottomans and the Arabs and the Israelis. So all this happening in this very, very small part of the world that is rich in resources, but rich mainly in civilizations. And now we are encountering in this small part of the world a new trend of political invasion, which is the terrorist organization that is being branded, that is originated from this part of the world, but that is being promoted and branded everywhere. And you see how it is now expanding from our region to other parts of the world. Because this experiment that was in Lebanon and the world was not contained geographically there due to first the means that they have, whether political, financial, military, and second, due to the technology that they benefited from, which is the internet and their access to reach the brain and the mind of each young person through their ideology, whether it is intellectual or religious, but they were able to have a high reach to people worldwide. And this is a kind of danger that is that was never seen, and that we believe we are facing it in Lebanon and in the region, but we are not able to nor to contain it, nor neither to eradicate it. And because we are not able to contain it, it's spreading. And this is why we are seeking the first the support from other countries, and second, the understanding that this is a threat that is imminent not only on Lebanon, that is imminent on every country that refuses the brand of Daesh or ISIS or Nusra or call it whatever you want. But this is a kind of a mode of you call it an epidemic, you call it Ebola, you call it whatever you want, but you see it in different names with the same ideology. You see it in Sudan, you see it in Shabab in Sudan, you see it in Boko Haram in Nigeria. We call it Daesh and Nusra and Syria and Iraq, in Egypt or Palestine, with different names. And in Lebanon, it changed its name 20 times with the same mode of decapitation of people, of murdering people, only for their difference in religion or lately in the way of life. How you shave, how you dress, how you eat. And you see the philosophy in allowing things to happen and not allowing other things to happen for women, for children. What is a woman made for? What is its role in society? How it is considered and perceived? And you know, they have a perception that, not a perception, a belief that woman, for example, is not a complete human being. And not that it is of a lesser degree, that it is of a lesser creation by God. And that's how God created her with less capabilities to perform in life so with less consideration as a human being. And this is not only a philosophical, conception of the woman. This is how she is treated. And she is treated to exist in the society or not to exist. So we are going backwards to thousands of years where we are allowing a movement or a group of people to exist, to occupy land, to seize new weapons, whether traditional or non-traditional, biological, and to have the means of financing themselves, and to recruit people through their means, and to spread their ideas through the internet. And I don't believe that the internet is not well, monitored through the servers that are well established. And you can follow any person in any location through satellite imaging, through the web, or through their means of financing. Well, yes, you can track any dollar. This is what happened after the 9/11, and this is what's more possible now. So with all these means, having a group of people like Daesh existing and spreading, this raises a very big question on the capability of the international community to deal with such threat, and on the ability of small countries to coexist with this, with these threats, or at least to address them properly. If the superpowers will decide, for a reason or another, maybe because for them the threat is not imminent, not to deal with them properly, then a big part of the world will be living under this threat and will not be protected on its basic right of existence, of life, where we are not here talking anymore of rights of expression or the right of belief. We are simply talking of the right to exist, where in our part of the world we are seeing that these groups are leaving people with no choice. Either you are killed, or you have to convert your religion, or you pay money, which is the jizya, to be able to stay in place. So with this kind of threat, we have no luxury of choosing our policy. Either we exist or we don't exist. And this is where we believe that the model that Lebanon represents, and the model that a country like here in Argentina, where due to my discussions today, I maybe discovered that yes, there is no fear of this threat, because here people are living in harmony, at least at this level of religion and at this level of social and political diversity, the threat is not imminent. But a society like yours, where you are having people coming from different parts of the world, cannot be tolerated later on by these people. So whenever they roll out in the world and they move from the Middle East to Europe, later on they will be able to cross the Atlantic and come to this part of the world. And this kind of difference in your society will not be accepted. Any kind of difference. So when we think now the threat is far, I can tell you that it is not, and it is imminent, and it is real, and it is decapitating people everywhere for any reason. In Moscow, we are seeing the terrorist attacks, and in China, in Australia, and in Europe, in Berlin, and in London and in Paris, in Africa, in Christian countries and in Muslim countries. And this is targeting all religions and all civilizations. And I think that an action is needed now, because the more we waste time, the more it gets difficult to deal properly with what's implanted in the minds of people. And this kind of transformation that we are witnessing in the minds of the people who are living in poverty or in luxury. You see doctors transforming into terrorists. This happened in 9/11. This happened in a big group of people who were arrested in the United Arab Emirates, where a group of a big network of doctors proved to have prepared for terrorist acts. And you see it also in places of misery, like the camps, Palestinian camps in Lebanon, or Syrian camps now in neighboring countries of Syria. So there are no rules for how people are being transformed. And there are no rules how these terrorists are acting. They are acting on no basis of any political project but the Sharia and but the Khalifa, which we had the authority, you know, to govern and to kill whoever objects. So our message from this visit, and our taking advantage of having the chance to talk to you, is to highlight the danger that we believe Lebanon is facing, our region is facing, and the whole world and the humanity are facing. Thank you for your time.